Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. The ungodly are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind driveth away. Therefore the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for the privilege of being here on this beautiful, sunshiny day. What a glorious time to be together. We're here, Lord, as you know, to celebrate the homegoing of one of our dear friends who has blessed us and enriched our lives. Thank you for Joe David Massey and the difference he has made here in the Bentonville community and at Pauline Baptist Church and at the Strickland's Crossroads Fire Department. He has made a difference by being here, and we thank you for letting us keep him as long as you have. Bless our time together. May we learn something about him that we did not know, and may we learn something about you in the process too. Thank you for your amazing love that sustains us through every trial and tribulation. And thank you for your love incarnate, Jesus our Lord. In his name we pray. Amen. I welcome you to this place. Thank you for coming. Thank you for your prayers. Thank you for the flowers. Thank you for your support, not just through Joe David's illness, but for a long time. You all have been amazing friends to him and his family, as I know he has been a friend to you. Marianne asked me to say thank you to you for picking the corn and plowing the fields when he was sick, for just dropping by to say hey and ask, is there anything I can do? Please keep that up. Please don't stop, because they, like all of us, need your love. Our Old Testament reading is the 23rd Psalm, and since many of you know that by heart, I invite you to say it with me. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen.
Thank you. My daddy used to sing that song here in this church many, many times. And it was sang by a group called SALT. S-A-A-L-T. Sarah, Annette, April, Lauren, and Travis. And we sang it just for him. But we just couldn't do it in person. So we recorded it. Just for those of you who do not know me, I am Annette Massey Adams, the oldest twin daughter of Joe David and Mary Ann Massey. And I want to thank each one of you for coming out today to celebrate my daddy. I know that my daddy will be so happy to hear Eli talk over me. And he would be happy that you're here. When I was thinking about what I would say today, I thought, how can any words that I say in 5 minutes really be enough? My daddy taught me so many things. How to ride a bicycle, how to drive his new John Deere 1020 tractor, and I'm not going to talk about what year that was. He taught me how to be slow to speak, and sometimes that it's better not to speak at all. But the most important thing that he taught me was who Jesus was, and he did that by imitating him. Joe David Massey was a disciple of Christ. He was a husband, daddy, papa, friend. He's a man who always gave his all to each of us who knew him. He loved sharing from the beautiful garden that he planted, and many of you have had some of his corn. My daddy enjoyed trying a different variety every now and then. Every year, it seemed like it was the best corn ever. Growing up, Jeanette and myself worked on the farm, and one of our first jobs was playing on the plant beds. We'd always pretend to be asleep, so Mom and Daddy would carry us out in a blanket and lay us in the back seat so we could just sleep a little longer. And then the next job we had, I remember walking behind a double-decker harvester, and the tobacco leaves that fell from those clips that went up to the tires, that was our job to pick it up. Then Daddy got a new harvester that was on one level, and he taught me and Jeanette how to drive that 1020 John Deere tractor I mentioned, which is in the picture of the back of the, on the back of the bulletin, which was taken about 2 months ago when he was bush hogging his garden. Me and Jeanette would have to use both feet and pull on the steering wheel to press the clutch in when someone said, whoa. And once or twice, we'd fall asleep at the wheel, and we'd wake up to, whoa! We had run over several ears of tobacco, and our daddy would hop on the tractor and straighten it up and get us back in the truck middle. He'd set up the tobacco, and he'd look at us and say, it's okay. You've got the toughest job out here. Our family has loved having you visit, your calls, your text. We've enjoyed the stories that you have told us over the past few days that we didn't know about. So please keep telling us those sweet memories you have. It kind of made me think in particular of one. I think I was in the fourth grade, and I told him I didn't have any homework. And then Teresa Lee, if you're here, your mom or dad came by and said, Teresa needs to borrow that science book to do her homework. Well, I knew I was in trouble. He only spanked me that one time, I think, in my life, and that was with his belt. And I knew I didn't ever want him to do that again, but it wasn't because the belt was painful. It was because he barely even touched me with it. It was that look of disappointment in his eye, and I knew I never wanted to see that again because I have only always looked up to him with respect and love. He has always been there to talk to when going through difficult times and give me godly wisdom. And he's going to continue to be with me through all of you. He will forever be missed, and the memories of him will forever be etched in my mind for as long as I breathe. His gentle spirit will be missed, but it will live on in me and Jeanette, Lauren, Luke David, Matthew Boone, Joseph Guy, and Elijah Ryan, better known as Eli. The Apostle Paul, through the power of the Holy Spirit, instructed us to live by the Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, patience, peace, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. And when I say these fruits, I think of my daddy, for they are a result of my daddy knowing Jesus. Do you know Jesus that way? If not, all you have to do is call on his name, and he will be there. Thank you again for coming out today to honor my daddy. And I know each of you are here because he has touched your life in some way. And it may be because we are here, and we will always be a part of him. He loved you all very much. So until we meet again, Daddy.
Good afternoon. I am Jeanette Massey McNeil. I am the youngest daughter of Joe David Massey, but by only 8 minutes. And Aunt used to think it was 8 years. So many lessons you learn growing up on a farm. There's so many lessons you learn growing up on a farm. A farm childhood is like any other, and that's a good thing. Farm families are bound strong because of shared experiences. Children growing up on a farm are not working for free. They are working and learning to make a life for a living. My daddy did not tell me how to live. He lived and let me watch. Growing up on Joe David's farm, you learned patience. Patience is a necessity. He might have a piece of equipment that just wouldn't work right, but he would continue to work on it until it was in working order. He remained calm and just handled it. I always had so much respect for my daddy with any challenge he had. I tried to follow that example by not stressing over things, but I'm still a work in progress. With my daddy, Joe David, family came first. All children learn by example, and our family was no different. If Annette and I were laying irrigation pipe not fast enough for him, or if we accidentally ran over some tobacco plants, we didn't talk about this when we were writing this, and so you're going to hear some similarities. Ran over some tobacco plants, or if it left suckers in the tobacco and he found them, he wouldn't get mad. He'd turn it into a lesson about using your time wisely and not making the same mistake again, to keep trying and to never give up. This also goes for learning a strong work ethic. What a strong work ethic is. It was not every day that you'd be home before dark for supper, especially during harvest time. Daddy taught us to respect the land and Mother Nature, and to respect other folks, and especially God. You know you're a farm kid if your family is instantly silent when the weather report comes on the news. It was so quiet, you knew not to say a word. You pray for the weather and hope for a good season. Mama and Daddy taught us to respect others and God. Attending and participating in this Pauline Baptist Church was a very important part of our lives, and they still is. You know, I always have the fear that one day someone will discover that I'm not as great as they thought I was. But my daddy never disappointed me. He was as great on his last day on earth as my first memory of him. Goodbyes are not forever. Goodbyes are not the end. They just simply mean, I'll miss you until we meet again. I am so proud to be this farmer's daughter. And I'll see you again soon, Daddy. I love you. I had no idea this day would come so soon. I think I can speak for everyone here today when I say I was not ready. My papa was an incredible man with a servant's heart and a contagious smile. He was such a patient man. He would always take the time to listen to what you had to say. I cannot remember an occasion or time that he was not present. Family meant everything to him. As most of you know, I was the first grandchild and the only girl. However, this did not stop me from being on the farm and getting dirty with my papa. Every summer while in grade school, I wanted to spend it on the farm with my papa. He taught me so many things. How to drive a tractor. This all sounds the same. Sorry, y'all. How to drive a tractor, how to plant a garden, how to care for show pigs, how to patch a tire, and most importantly, he taught me the importance of following the Lord through his Christian example. My sweet papa would be the first person to drop everything that he had going on to go help someone that was in need. I always told papa that I knew I was his favorite grandchild since I was the first and only girl. He would always snicker and say that he didn't have a favorite. I do believe this changed on August 30th, 2020, when Eli Ryan was born. But we had a longer stay at Wake Med when he was born than we anticipated, but as soon as we got home, Papa was there waiting and grinning from ear to ear. There are not many days that we didn't hear his Nissan pickup in the front yard just stop and it sit there and wait. And he would just be sitting there waiting patiently for you to open the door so he could come get his hands on Eli. Yep. And Eli loves his papa so much. If I told you all the memories I had of my papa, we'd probably be standing here for at least a month or longer, so I won't do that to you. I'm so thankful that God blessed me with almost 27 years of knowing my papa. He and Granny Mary Ann inspired me to follow my dreams of becoming a nurse to help others in need. On Wednesday, September 29th, 2021, my breath was taken away. My granny, mama, aunt, and myself surrounded my papa in the ICU. We prayed for no suffering and no pain. Catherine, a hospital chaplain, came in to check on us. We were telling stories about our sweet papa, daddy, and husband. And after a few short minutes, I noticed Papa's heart rate begin to decrease on the monitor. I asked Catherine, I said, will you please stop and pray right now? Please pray. And Catherine prayed, and she said, Jesus, please open your arms and allow Mr. Joe David to come and be with you in heaven. And immediately, his heart stopped. We were so astonished and speechless and breathless. Our sweet Papa, Joe David, was with Jesus. We did cry. But instead of tears of pain, we cried tears of joy because we were at peace. We had the most overwhelming peace. And we still do. It's just tough, but we still do. And we know where this man is at in his spirit. There is no doubt in our mind we know he's with Jesus. Revelation 21:4 says, he will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away. Stand firm in your faith. Remember the importance of putting Jesus first and treating others with compassion and the love of Jesus. Kyle and I will be sure that Eli never forgets his papa, and will teach him the importance of loving Jesus and others, just as papa did. Today, I'm grateful for the promise of spending eternity in heaven with Jesus and all the ones who have gone on before, especially my papa.
We read of a city John saw coming down from God out of heaven. River of life that flows from the throne. such a good place for us to be over there. And after I find you, let's go see Jesus.
Then let's go find our dad, our mother. Let's meet by the river over on that beautiful shore.
At the conclusion of the service, after the fire department has rendered their honors and respects, the family will go to the grave for just a few minutes, and they ask that you give them that private time. And then when they come back to the tent, they would love to talk with you and hug your necks and spend some time talking about Mr. Joe David. So thank you for understanding and cooperating. I've been a pastor in Johnston County since 1985, and in all that time, I've never messed up the Lord's Prayer. Messed it up today. Thou anointest my head with oil. See, I do know where that phrase goes. I messed it up because my mind went totally blank, because I'm still trying to figure out what to leave out to say about Mr. Joe David. If you knew him, you know he wanted to talk to you. He was the most personable fella, but really he didn't want to talk to you. He wanted to let you talk and he would listen. Now, if you had a question and you asked him, he would tell you what he thought. If he had thought it through, you might say something to him and he would be quiet for a little while till he figured it out. But when he did figure it out, how many of you old enough to remember the old E.F. Hutton commercials? When E.F. Hutton speaks, everybody listens. Well, that's the way it was with Joe David Massey. If I needed to talk something over, if I needed somebody to give me some good understanding of how life went, I could always ask Joe Massey. I've been a pastor here since September, 11 years ago. And in all that time, when I called Joe David, he did anything I asked. Anything. If we were planning a baptismal service, I would call him and remind him on Saturday night, just to make sure. And on Sunday morning, when I would come in the front door, he would be standing at the front of the church with his hand down in the water saying, "Is it hot enough for you, preacher?" If we were having the Lord's Supper, "Hey, Joe David, Lord's Supper's this weekend." Usually it was him reminding me, by the way, because he was really good at keeping up with things. And if he wasn't, Mary Ann was. And whatever this church needed, He was glad to do it. He didn't do it because he had to. He was glad to do it. Don't run into many people like that. I found three words that start with F that describe him today. First, he was a man of faith, as you all have already said. If there's anybody in heaven that ever deserved to go to heaven, it's him. I have no doubt of that. When Jesus was on the cross, he was crucified between two thieves. And one of them made fun of him. If you're the Son of God, get off of that cross and save us all. And the other one said, don't mock him. He's the Christ. And Jesus said to that second thief, he said, today you're going to be with me in paradise. And that word paradise is another way of saying the Garden of Eden, which in Jewish thought is saying, you're going to be with me in heaven today. Folks ask me what it's like when we die. I have no idea. But I trust Jesus. And what he said to the thief is good enough for me. Today, you'll be with me in paradise. When we heard about a family in need, Joe David and I would have a conversation. He would check with the Sunday school director and the director of WMU. And within no time flat, there would be a check going to that family. And he would deliver it. He just loved doing that kind of thing. A couple of weeks ago, we were down at a house down the street here putting a tarp on. And this guy with rheumatoid arthritis in his hands, was up there on a ladder, nailing into that tarp to make sure that it didn't blow off. And he nailed until his hands hurt so bad that he had to stop. But he stayed there until all of us finished and all of us left. He wanted to see the job done, and he wanted to see it done right. He was a kind of particular man. When he found out that some guys were getting ready to harvest his corn, he had a phone conversation with him. He said, don't you touch that corn. It's not ready to pick yet. It's got too much moisture in it. Well, they picked it anyway, and we're glad they did, because they found ways to dry it out down to the right humidity. But nonetheless, he knew how something ought to be done. After all, he farmed that land all of his life. He did take a job doing some logging once, Marianne told me. But the rest of the time, that was when the twins were a little bit younger, and I'm not going to say which one is older. I have absolutely no idea. I still cannot tell them apart. I just look to see which man they're standing beside. I can tell the guys apart. But he did teach his family to love the Lord. He taught them to work hard, and he taught them by example. He didn't complain. I never heard him gossip. He was one of those steady, sturdy guys. And we would stand out here on this front porch that he supported and helped make sure it got built properly. And I would say, now, Mr. Joe David, I know you're getting an infusion pretty soon. I said, you better be careful and not catch COVID. He said, I'm not worried about it. I know where I'm going. I know where I'm going. Second word, first word is faith. The second word, he loved his family more than he loved farming, if that's possible. When any of the kids came around, his face would light up. And those pictures of him and Eli, oh my goodness gracious. He loved his kids, he loved his grandchildren, and now his great one. Whenever we would have children's sermon here at the church, and Shannon or somebody would get up with the kids coming down, he would just grin from ear to ear, from ear to ear. He loved kids. I think at heart he was one, a simple, kind, caring, childlike guy. honest, earnest, but innocent in some ways that I'm not, for sure. I remember a couple of years ago when a car hit your shelter where all the farm equipment was. I drove down there to check it out to see what was going on. He didn't fuss, he didn't complain, he didn't say bad things about the driver who had run off the road. He just told me his plans to fix everything. No big deal, Robert. It's just a thing. If it's broke, it can be fixed, and if it can't be fixed, it can be thrown away and replaced. What an attitude. What an attitude. Finally, he loved this fire department. Put in 30 years there, was the second fire chief. Loved you guys. If there was something going on at the fire department, we heard about it up here. If the fire department was having a dinner, y'all come eat with us. He has loved you guys and just invested himself in that. And that has a particular meaning to me because in July 1987, my house caught on fire. And Joe David and some of you were among the people that came and put that fire out. Little did I know that one day I would have the privilege of serving as pastor for some of you. So thank you for 1987, that nobody got hurt, nobody got burned, and everything worked out all right. And thank you for the privilege of serving as your pastor. I neglected a moment ago to read our scripture from the New Testament. I'm going to rectify that in closing. Reading from Matthew chapter 11, some of my favorite words from Jesus. He said, "All things are delivered unto me of my Father, and no man knoweth the Son but the Father, neither knoweth any man the Father save the Son, and he to whomsoever the Son will reveal him. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light." I always wondered why the word funeral began with F-U-N. Why such a dreary, solemn thing has to be so doggone serious. And then it occurred to me that it doesn't have to be serious because there can be a time to smile. So as we close, I want to ask, how many of you like pirate movies? Anybody here like pirate movies? Excellent. Pirate movies are a lot of fun. I love them. But if you ever know, just in every good pirate movie, there's a treasure chest, right? And what does that treasure chest look like in every pirate movie? It has a round top, and it has handles on the sides. And what do with that treasure chest? We bury it someplace secret where no one can find it. Well, I say to you, this is a treasure chest because it contains the body of our dear friend, Joe David. And we're going to take it in a moment and bury it over here, not in secret, but in public, and put a stone up where everybody can come and visit and talk to him that wants to, because we want to remember him. Remember the good things he did. Rejoice with the family that he and Marianne have created. But we want to remember him. He wasn't a pirate. He's the closest thing I've ever met to a saint. An absolute true saint. Would you pray with me? Father God, we thank you for your love. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you for a really good man. And although, Lord, this road we're on called life is really curvy and we can't see over the horizon, we know that there's eternal life over there just around the bend. And thank you that Mr. Joe David is there waiting on us. Tell him hello for us. Tell him how much we love him and we miss him. Brother Joe, may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and all of us and give us your peace. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Gentlemen, this time we'll be doing our flag folding ceremony by the honor guard, followed by the ringing of the bells and the fireman's last call.
most of history, the life of a firefighter has been closely associated with the ringing of a bell. As he begins his hours on duty, it's the bell that calls him to fight fires and place his life in jeopardy for the good of his fellow man. And when the fire was out and the alarm had come to an end, the bell rang three times to signal the end. And now our brother J. Lovett has completed his task. His duty's well done. And the bell rings in three times in memory of and in tribute to his life and his service to this community and this township.
All firefighters, attention. Raise your arm.
folks, as Dr. Cook said, the family will come back up. They invite you to step down to look at Mr. Joe David's vault, for his home place is on top of that vault, and it's really special to them. So in a moment, they'll come back up, and you're welcome to step down and see it. Thank you so much, and have a blessed evening.